Okay, welcome back to The Man with the Golden Stream. Today we'll actually be playing Tomorrow Never Dies. We had some technical difficulties last week, so I was only able to do the bonus mission in GoldenEye, and for whatever reason my Elgato would not connect to my PS2, so we weren't able to do this last time. But I got it to work, so everything's up and running and looking good now. And also a quick update, I will not be streaming next week. Next Sunday is going to be WrestleMania, and I'll be watching that. We'll pick up the stream the week after that. Anyway, so today we will be playing Tomorrow Never Dies on PS1, which was a game I don't believe was being made concurrent to GoldenEye, but at least within a close enough time frame that this was made not quite when GoldenEye became a hit. You know, it was probably a hit at the time, like when this game came out. I think this came out like a year later, but they were already steeped in development of this game before GoldenEye became what it is. So this game is going to be a lot different than a lot of other games that we'll be playing afterwards, which is interesting. I kind of like the idea of someone else doing something with it other than following the GoldenEye formula, which we'll kind of be seeing throughout the course of the Bond and video game franchise. But anyway, let's go ahead and get started here. Do it on that, yep. And I believe, I remember this game being a lot easier than GoldenEye, so I may be able to get just burned through this entire game in one sitting. We'll see. What is this thing anyway? Is it like a 007, like a communicator or I don't know what this design is. It's a weird thingy. Confirmed that they are using a high-powered communications dish to illegally decode the positions of our GPS satellites. Your first job is to laser designate the dish for an immediate airstrike. Remember to keep a safe distance from the target. We can't afford to lose you, 007. All right then. So that's the first thing you're gonna notice about this game over. Excuse me. One moment. Okay, that's better. So that's probably gonna be the first thing you're gonna notice about this game over GoldenEye. It has actual cutscenes and voiceover work, which is due probably to the PlayStation 1 using disc-based formats instead of the N64 using the cartridges. Now, I know, I haven't played much of it, but I know that the next game on the N64 is going to have a bit of voice work, but this one, I think they, you know, it's a much better format for that kind of stuff. But as you can see, this is a third-person shooter, or a third-person action game. Feels a tiny bit like Tomb Raider in the way the controls work, but it is not as fluid as controls. Like, Tomb Raider, come on, yes. It's like a mix between Tomb Raider and Metal Gear Solid, like with the way the equipment works like that. But it is not a particularly fluid experience the way that Tomb Raider is. By the way, I'm just going to get this out of the way. I do actually like this game. I don't think it's as aged as well as GoldenEye, but I think it's a fun little experience. Let's see. Oh, that's how you crouch. Oh! Well then, that didn't last very long. But also a benefit here, they let you have lives, that's nice. Unlike GoldenEye, we have to do it all in one go. Which is fine, but combine that with the very unforgiving difficulty at times, it can be kind of a pain. Okay, so far so good, even though I died once. So that's how you aim, and you can do the slow walk, you can roll around, we go all roly-poly here. Roly-poly. Oh. Oh, and I got a sniper rifle. That's good. That's a triangle. But like with GoldenEye, it is also objective-based. So you got this level, and you got to complete the objectives within it. Laser designate dish, obtain security card, escape on skis. So that's what we got to do this time. The information that Judi Dench gave us at the beginning of the level, It doesn't, I don't remember, maybe I wasn't paying attention this time, but it didn't seem like it was very specific on level-based help, more than it was just setting up the stage and doing the story part. But the objectives don't seem that complicated. Another thing right away, pause menu, not as good as it is in GoldenEye. No music. That's like the main thing that's kind of throwing me off is the no music. And to a certain extent, you know, it's kind of nice that, well, it's a little bit helpful that you don't have to wait for the whole arm animation, which can be a pain in harder difficulties. But, you know, I kind of miss that, you know. Like, there's no real animation of him opening it. Like, as you can see, it's just, it appears and then it's opening. We don't zoom into his perspective, really, as he's pulling it out. Yeah, it's just not quite as... Oh, actually, that's something I want to see if I can fix. Nope. Alright, I think that will do it. Whoop. Okay, that one. You can see the guy there. I think the graphics actually look pretty nice. I like the fact that they breathe out the steam like you would in the snow. That's a nice little touch there. So it has a very... This game does have a very good first level, just like GoldenEye does. Oh. Woo! And there you go, he fell out. That's good. Okay. And the music's pretty good too. I like this particular riff in this level. Whoa! Someone's shooting me, I don't know where. Is that guy? Whoa! Mom's got me. Oh, that's not good. Oh, come on, come on! There we go, okay. I'll just go ahead and grab this. One thing that is not good about this game is there is no reload button. I've never been able to figure out how to reload. So you just gotta use up the rest of your clip, and then hopefully you're not in the middle of something when they gotta do the reload animation. Whoa! Nope. Yeah, and I'm down. Oh my gosh, these guys will not go down. Oh! They kept that in at least. Okay then, that did not go well. I think I'm just gonna go on agent mode for this. Don't really want to spend 4 hours on the same level like I did at some points with GoldenEye. Let's go. Did I choose it? Nope. Okay. And loading screens. That is a hallmark of disc-based games, so kind of a pain there. Oh well. Make sure everything here is fine. Okay, everything looks good on the stream. Okay, military outpost in Russia. So, what are we doing again? There's like a spy... There's like a laser tower that's spying on us or something. He didn't even drop his gun. Oh, that's fine. Okay. Gonna run past. Ooh, they didn't even notice me. Might be able to get a headshot in. Yes! That's good. Little design thing there. If you just shoot the guy, sometimes it'll give like a little white explosion thing there. But you know that it's a kill shot if it's a red. It's a nice visual signifier. And I am not hitting anything. I was gonna come around eventually. Oh. Yeah, anytime you see red, that means that they're dead. Oh, I got this guy. I got him. I think I missed something. I think there's some body armor up here. Should have checked. Yep. Now let's try and play it a bit cool. Oh! Nope! Not playing it cool. Not playing it cool. Still getting shot at. Go ahead and... Nope. I think they just stopped. This guy. I think he's shooting at me. Oh. Okay. So I guess I was wrong. I saw a little white explosion thingy there. But apparently he died, so maybe the blood red thing isn't always a signifier. Ooh! Ah, come on! How do you shoot me with an assault rifle from that distance? Are you kidding me? Ugh, at least I got him, but still. Ah, dang it. Okay. That's what I need. Heavy armor. Okay. Where are they? They're loaded in my presence, at least, but I don't know where they went. Oh, I saw someone up there. Okay. Yep. I got you. Whoa. Who's shooting at me? Oh, I see him. Oh, well. At least not one, Oh! Is that like... Come on. So the moment I get the body armor, the guy just starts shooting at me. I thought I killed this guy. Are they just respawning? I just keep strafing. Okay, so far so good. Made it to the cave, at least. I don't know if they know I'm here yet. Where the heck is he going? Oh, okay. Probably not the best idea to go out in the open like that. Do they see me still? I don't know. Well, let's see if I can, Whoa! Okay, there we go. Okay, I have a med kit in case I need it, which you probably will. Okay, that guy right there. No, why do I still have that? Okay. Ah, can't hit him. Okay, gotta climb up. What the heck? Okay, there we go. Okay, doesn't seem to work too well when you're that close to him. Anyway, yeah. So, first objective is to laser designate the dish. I got a weapon, I got an item called a laser. There's a dish right there. I'm sure I can put two and two together.
Keep the target painted.
Alright, so now we have a siege on our hands. But I think it's just the one helicopter, so if you get right up to the helicopter, you can just kill them as they're coming down. I have to get a key card. I don't know where the key card is. Oh, there it is. Alright then. So you just gotta wait for the guy to drop it and then you can get out of here. And now it's time to ski. So I've not seen Tomorrow Never Dies. I actually haven't seen any Bond movies since, Man with the Golden Gun. I said I was going to watch more, but I just didn't have time this week. So I haven't seen Tomorrow Never Dies, and I don't know if there is a ski scene in that movie. What this reminded me of, though, is On Her Majesty's Secret Service, which has a pretty phenomenal skiing scene in it. But it's not the only one. I saw a bit of The Spy Who Loved Me. There was a pretty good skiing scene in that one, too. So it might just be a motif for the series. Oh my, get off. Oh jeez, come on. Get off. I'm stabbing him and it ain't doing anything. There we go, okay, out of the way. Okay, get the head, no kits. Okay, good. Now, just keep going. Okay. No big deal, no big deal. Probably not the perfect time to be doing tricks there. And I didn't do it. It automatically does that whenever you jump. I don't know why. It only seems to hurt. Okay, hit a tree. That's good. Oh. No, I'm dead. Oh, threading the needle. Ha! Oh, not good. Okay. Not gonna thread the needle there. There we go. Made it. I think. Okay, I did make it. Alright then, that was the first level. So far, so good. I don't know what these scores mean. I don't know. I'll just go and continue. So again, I don't know what I'm looking at here. Is it a communicator?
Good job.
I don't know.
Destroying the dish. Your drop zone should be just outside a terrorist arms bazaar on the Russian border. 5 days ago, a reconnaissance team deployed several remote video cameras. But they've stopped transmitting due to the severe cold. We believe a major transaction is happening soon, possibly involving the exchange of stolen weapons. You must infiltrate the bazaar and photograph the weapons. Check your cell phone's objective screen for more details.
Okay, so I'm at the bazaar. I have to photograph the weapons. That does tell us something, but the whole check your objective screen for more details. Well, let's see how good that is. Okay. Arms Bazaar, Russia, blah blah. You know, if you're a secret agent, you probably don't want the Union Jack on your parachute. I'm just saying. Okay, so objectives, photograph. Okay, that actually does give us details. Exactly what weapons we need to take a photograph of. Chopper, mortars, Scud, and locate cockpit key. Okay, we'll get to that in a minute, but let's just go ahead and start with the photos. Oop. Okay. I don't know who's shooting me already. Okay, so I'm guessing this is the Scud. I mean, it looks like a weapon, so I'm gonna just take a picture of it. Yep, okay. And they give you the little indication on the left-hand side that you actually did do something right. So that is a bit of an improvement over GoldenEye, where you would have objectives where you have to, like, do this thing 5 times, or destroy all these thingies. And it doesn't give you an indication Why am I not shooting? What happened? Why was I not shooting? I was pressing the X button. But anyway, that is a slight improvement over GoldenEye, where you would have these objectives, like, destroy the brake thingies. And you're like, okay, I think I know what the brake thingies are, but you're not going to know for sure until you've destroyed all of them. So that is kind of that was kind of an issue with GoldenEye. I'm just trying to think of, you know, someone who's playing it for the first time. Where this one has that little extra bit to let you know that you are doing a good job. All right. Loading. Okay, there we go. Oh, and the splash screen here shows you a extra life there, a little spinny thingy. So, you know, that does serve a bit of a utilitarian purpose, having that little splash screen there, on top of just showing you an idea of what the level looks like. So, you know, the game did not have to stop and tell me what a extra life looks like and stuff like that. Oh, come on. That was so on money. Come on. Alright, well, he's down. Oh, okay. Maybe I can get this guy without him noticing me. Oh, okay. Back up, back up. Okay, there he is. I don't think he knows where I am. It's probably wishful thinking, but we'll soon find out. Yep, he sees me. Okay, I got him. Do I have any medkits? So, another thing here, they don't tell you this, but you do have sticky mines in your inventory. If you bother to look through your inventory, you'll find them. But sticky mine and STK mine and STK detonator. That seems clear enough. If someone playing for the first time, that might be clear enough to them to indicate that they have to do that. Now, why you need them is not entirely clear, but we'll get to that in just a moment. Let me go ahead and get these weapons pictured. Am I supposed to get closer? Okay, here we go. There we go, okay. Okay, so The reason I bring up the sticky mines is, at this point in the level, you've taken the the pictures of the two things. You know there's supposed to be a third thing, but you can't find it. You know, it's a very small, enclosed area. Where's the third thing you're looking for? And this is where you gotta do a bit of deduction. I don't know how I figured it out initially, but just something I know. Yeah, so you got this whole area here. It's not particularly big, but you can see the entirety of it. Except you got this massive wall right here. So if you take the deductive leap, you can probably assume that you use the sticky mines on the thingy. And then you detonate. And there you go. There's your third picture thing to take a picture of. Ah! Come on. Go down. There you go. Oh, one more. Okay, there we go, camera. There we go. Okay.
White Knight, the British Navy has just launched a Tomahawk cruise missile to destroy the bazaar. Evacuate immediately.
I just need a little more time.
I don't know if that's Pierce Brosnan. I'm just going to assume it is. And that guy was not there before. But you get the cutscene, and it does raise the stakes a bit. Doesn't really tell you what to do next. But, I mean, there's a door here. So you just go to the door. And now it opens.
White
and it
Rook,
wouldn't open before.
We have a problem. That jet is armed with Soviet SB-5 nuclear warheads. If the incoming cruise missile detonates those warheads, you're going to have a nuclear disaster.
The Tomahawk is out of range. We cannot abort the missile. Repeat, we cannot abort the missile. Get out of there now!
I have to evacuate that jet.
Okay, so you got this mission. It's only got a 2-minute timer. Just gonna go over something real quick here. So another technical limitation of GoldenEye. It wasn't able to have cutscenes like that. I mean, I'm sure maybe they could have paused the action and shown like two characters standing there with text bubbles or something. But what that means is that at least in this game, you get to have the cutscenes, which give you it allows the objectives to change essentially. Because in GoldenEye, you got the objectives at the beginning of the level. Then you were thrown in the level, and sure, sometimes something might change a little bit, but for the most part, you knew exactly what you were doing as you were going in. Here, it allows mid-level changes. So while that objective on the screen before was a bit vague, find the key to the cockpit or something, it did allow for this to exist, where you can have, oh, I had my objective at the beginning of the match, not the match, at the beginning of the level, but then something changed in the middle of it, and now I gotta compensate for that. I gotta think quickly and stuff like that. So now we got a 2-minute timer, and the objective was to find the cockpit key, and there's a giant plane there. So if we can find the key, we go to the plane, we end the level, we're good. Alright, so let's see if we can do this without dying. Oh boy, this isn't gonna go well. See if we can take this guy out. Oh, heavy armor. Okay. So I don't remember. I think it's just on one of the guys. You just gotta keep killing people until... There you go, you get the cockpit key. And I'm just gonna grab this extra life here. Again, they showed you this during the intro cutscene, or if you can call it a cutscene. So there you go, you can pick it up, and you get extra life. So that's, again, telling you something without having to stop the game to tell you what it is. Enter! What the heck? Do I have to kill all the enemies first? And now that I think about it, this level is actually a lot like that one level in... There we go, okay. It's actually a lot like that one level in GoldenEye where you, what was that one? The one where you were escaping the facility after 006? Was it 006? Yeah, after 006 died. We had to, you know, destroy all the enemies, get in an airplane, and then whoosh, fly away. And I think this is entirely pointless, this little bit here, but, you know... If you got an airplane, a jet fighter with missiles, why not blow stuff up? I always thought this part was so cool. Yeah, this is a really good introductory level. I don't think the game really ever rises to this level again, but it's a really great way to start off the game. And of course, it leads us right into the opening sequence, which the other game, GoldenEye, wasn't able to do because of the technology. You know, we get actual cutscenes from the movie. So again, I haven't seen Tomorrow Never Dies. I think that's the one where the bad guy is Ted Turner or something. Like, the guy manipulates wars to sell newspapers or something. I haven't seen that one. I'm working on them. I'm working on movies. It's from the movie, yeah. Oh, that's interesting. They changed the aspect ratio. Is this introduction unique to the game? Because they switched aspect ratio for some reason. Or they may have just cropped the movie's intro to like 3:4 or whatever it is. I don't think I ever noticed that. Now, I think these are the credits for the game, not the movie itself. I don't think John Boddy was the guy who directed the movie. Let me double check that. John Boddy. Yeah, lead artist. Yeah, these are cutscenes from the game. Or these are credits from the game. Let's see. They clipped the intro from the movie. Yeah. Okay, so I figured they probably didn't have the budget to make a whole new intro, but it's kind of interesting that they didn't crop the movie scenes, but crop the introduction. Or the opening, whatever you call it. And I hope I don't get, like, a copyright claim for showing this part of the... I mean, I'm sure this is a copyright song and all that stuff. I feel like I looked this up recently. It was Roger Spottiswood was the director of the movie. What else did he do? Let's see. Let's see. Filmography... 48 Hours. That's a movie with a... Oh, he was a writer on that. So he wrote 48 Hours. Under Fire, Shoot to Kill. I don't know these movies. Oh, that's right. This is the guy who... Okay, so the guy who directed Tomorrow Never Dies also directed Stop or My Mom Will Shoot. The movie where Stallone was a cop and his mother had a gun or something like that. I never saw the movie, but yeah, that's interesting. The Sixth Day, that's the Schwarzenegger movie where he's a clone or something. She Came with the Devil. Right Wrong. Midnight Sun. A Street Cat Named Bob. So apparently Roger Spottiswood's last movie was A Street Cat Named Bob. Okay, then. Electronic Arts. Okay, yeah, I was actually wondering that. Was this Electronic Arts? Because they got the Bond license. I don't know if they still have it, but they certainly got the Bond license after Rare. Like, I remember there was a thing where they were like, the James Bond company, I don't know, Broccoli Corporations, EON, whatever they call it. They were trying to, there was like a bidding war for the next Bond game after Tomorrow Never Dies and GoldenEye for The World Is Not Enough, and EA won that over Rare. Okay, but yeah, we got that one done. So I don't know how that opening level connects to the rest of the story.
Last night, the British naval vessel Devonshire was sunk in the South China Sea. We believe Elliot Carver may have played a part, since his newspaper Tomorrow printed the story before our intelligence team had received a full report. Carver is hosting a large party tonight, and will be busy broadcasting the...
So they think a guy who owns a newspaper sunk a ship just to get a story. And I'm guessing that's going to turn out to be true, but... And again, I don't know how this connects to the mission we just did. There was something about spy satellites and a airplane. Maybe that terrorist organization is in some way connected to this guy and his newspaper. Yeah, already things, like, so, I hate it, I wish we still had the rights, because then the GoldenEye remake would have been way better. I actually have the GoldenEye remake both on Wii and Xbox 360. I'm going to get to those eventually. I also have the GoldenEye game they did for PS2, Rogue Agent or something. I mean, I understand the sentiment that you don't want EA to still have the rights. I mean, no one wants EA to have the rights to anything, but... Ugh, dang it. Man, this is a dark level. Hold on. But the thing is, you know, what has Rare done recently to make us think that they would be able to pull it off? Like, I love old-school Rare, but there's a reason why modern Rare hasn't been as well-lauded. You know, the best thing Rare came out with in the last 10 years has been a re-release of their old games. But, I don't know if anything particularly changed. I'm pretty sure EA still has the exclusive license, you say. But yeah, they actually have also been making a lot fewer James Bond games. If you look at the timeline of James Bond games, they were making them almost every year, maybe once every... Come on. Wait, is that the same sound? I think that sound effect is also in, GoldenEye. That sounds like a familiar alarm sound. What the heck was I getting on about? Oh, but they appreciate they're making game. EA just cares about money. I mean, they all care about money. There's no one's making a game hoping they don't sell a lot of copies. But EA is, not doing too well. And they also, I mean, they're making fewer games. If you look at the timeline, during the PS2 era, and even part of the 360 era, they were making James Bond games every 1 to 2 years. Last one we got was Legends, and what was that, 2014? Yeah, it's been a while since we got a James Bond game. But also on top of that, we've also been getting... What am I even doing? I'm kind of distracted here. Okay, so let's go back. Let's take a moment here. Rendezvous with Paris. Cut the power. Destroy central computer. Escape. Not too descriptive here. The introduction with Judi Dench did not mention Paris. So unless you saw the movie, you probably don't know who Paris is. I haven't seen the movie, but I know this level. Cut the power. Destroy central computer. And escape. So not particularly clear objectives, but if you look around, you may be able to find something. Let's see. Let's check the doors. I haven't even checked the doors yet. Alright, let me double check. I think they're... Don't think I was supposed to blow that up, but... Alright. Can I check this door? Alright, it's locked. The only game EA made right was... Need for Speed Underground, Need for Speed Underground 2, and Most Wanted. The first Most Wanted. The new one sucks, and I regret buying it. Yeah, didn't they put microtransit? I'm not a big into the Need for Speed games, so but I know the recent remakes and whatever they've been doing with Need for Speed have been pretty disappointing. Okay. Do I have an assault rifle yet? Ooh, I have an SMG. I didn't know that. Come on. Okay. And I'm out. Okay. Alright, so there's Paris. Do I have to...
I wonder what it would feel like if I ever saw you again. Now I know.
That's for walking out on me.
Okay.
Well... I feel much better. Now, what brings you here?
Paris, someone in your husband's organization was involved in the sinking of the Devonshire and the murder of those British sailors. You don't know anything about that, do you?
Elliot's company is involved in many things, James. I don't keep track of them all.
Look, I'm sorry what happened between us, but I need your help.
Well, I know there's a restricted lab.
Mrs. Bond. Would you allow me to give you a tour of the facilities?
Okay. So, there's a bit of uncanniness here that I will get to in just a minute. But going back to you, I know everyone wants to make money, but that's what happens when all you care about are microtransactions ruined games, and, well, sorry, I'm old school. Yeah, and I mean, I'm trying to think of games that I like that are of the modern age. Mostly Nintendo stuff. Stuff that appears on the Switch. Ooh, what is that? Is a new... Now hosting my stream with One Views. Ooh, nice. I apologize. Tony JR88 is now hosting my stream. I'm still very, very, very new to streaming. I actually don't know what that means. I just made a graphic because it was like a thing to make a graphic for. But thank you so much for doing that. Is that the thing where you have your own stream and then instead of like streaming your own thing, you're like linking to someone else's? I think that's what it is. But yeah, I know everyone wants to make... What was I... as I said, I'm new to streaming, so I can get distracted very easily. But going back to the thing about the old school, yeah. I don't want to harp too harshly on any specific aspect of the modern gaming industry versus old school, because the thing is, it too often boils down to too broadly making definitive statements. The thing about microtransactions is, yes, they are bad. I think I'm new to Twitch as well. I think so I'm new to Twitch as well, yeah. But thank you, Tony MJ Junior 88. So getting back to the conversation. So yeah, with microtransactions, they're bad. There's no doubt about it. And, you know, I watch the Jim Sterling videos too and all that stuff. But, you know, there is good stuff about modern gaming. There's stuff about games that didn't work back then that work much better now. So I don't want to harp on it too much. But yes, I do feel like EA has not been making right choices, but a lot of people have been making right choices as far as the AAA game industry. We're seeing all the contraction of the studios. Yeah, we're seeing all the studios having the massive layoffs and all that stuff, even with these, you know, with the microtransactions and the extraordinary budgets. I think there's more to it than just saying that microtransactions are bad or this one studio is bad over other studios, but I do understand the feeling. And I'm sure once I get to the later games, there'll be stuff that I complain about those too. But, you know, the old school wasn't perfect. Cartridges and old school CDs, issues with those. And there's more you can do with a single game now than you could have done with an entire library back then. You know, like that. Yeah, you couldn't make a game like Sekiro even 10 years ago. And, you know, that's... I don't know. Does that game have microtransactions? I doubt it. But there's still parts of the gaming industry that are fantastic. And it's like with anything. You know, you see newer movies. You have a better idea of what's out there for the new movies than the older movies. So you can say, oh, movies were better back then. Well, no. Did you see all... Are you watching all the movies that came out at that time? There were a lot of terrible movies back then. We just remember the good ones. But yeah. So... EA bad, but there's nuance to everything regarding that stuff. So where am I going? Oh, there was something else we were going to talk about. The uncanniness. Okay, so with GoldenEye, there was a sort of... I'm trying to phrase it the right way, but it did feel like very much like a game. Like, it was a lot of assets thrown into an environment and expertly put together, of course, but it didn't not feel like a game. This one is trying to ape a film aesthetic a lot closer. Man, don't get me started with the movies. I actually like the modern James Bond movies. Spectre wasn't too great, but, you know, I have rewatched them recently and they are really good. So this game is trying to ape a much more film authentic aesthetic, but it also... What am I doing? I can't remember what I'm supposed to do here. Am I supposed to blow that up? Okay, I am already lost. I have no idea what I'm supposed to be doing here. It's locked. Why is it locked? And why is it so dark in here? Jeez. Am I missing something? I feel like I'm missing something very obvious, and I'm gonna look very foolish in a minute. I don't see anything. What is that, ammo? Oh, the door remote? Huh. Okay, then. I do not remember ever getting that. Okay, but the uncanniness. So yeah, this game is trying to ape a much more film experience, where GoldenEye felt like a game that happened to be based on a license. This one feels like the game version of a movie, but look at the level design. Where exactly are we? This doesn't feel like a place that is real. And then when you get to the scene, just Paris is sitting in the middle of a room, and then just two guys come out to pick you up. It feels very off, certain aspects of this game, because they are trying to get that, like, film feeling to it, more so than GoldenEye was able to with its technology. What can I help you with the game, but I was always stuck on GoldenEye. I already did GoldenEye, like, 3 weeks ago. Like, the last 3 weeks have been GoldenEye. I think that one so far has a clearer sense of objectives in this game. Like, this game isn't too hard, but it is not as clear as GoldenEye. GoldenEye is kind of like a masterwork. This one is kind of an arcade fun thing. I'm kind of stumbling over my words here, just trying not to die. Okay. Oh, jeez. Okay. Ah, come on. I wonder if it's too late to lower the difficulty. But yeah, I mean, just trying to put together the aesthetic of this level, it feels weird. Like, is this the front door? And then over here is the desk to the reception area. But then we got this, which is an elevator to... Is that a door or an elevator? And then you got the Hall of His Faces, which is interesting. An interesting design choice. And then she's just kind of standing here. It feels a little weird. Very game-like. Like, it feels very much like a game, but, like, we got the film stuff kind of going against it. So it does feel a little odd, like a little, like they're rubbing up against each other.
Your husband's organization was involved in the sinking of the Devonshire and the murder of those British sailors. You don't know anything about that, do you?
Elliot's company is involved in many things, James. I don't keep track of them all.
Look, I'm sorry what happened between us, but I need your help.
Well, I know there's a restricted lab.
Ah, Mr. Bond. Won't you allow me to give you a tour of the facilities?
And she's still standing there as they knock you out. Like, she's right there! Okay, so that happens, and of course they leave you with a weapon. You got these things. So, action, it just says action, and cufflinks. Medkits and cufflinks. So, first time you're playing it, you wake up here, you got a thingy here, so it says cufflinks. Now let's check here. Objectives. Just gives you your objectives, doesn't give you any information about the item itself. So that can be... No. Continue. But again, I guess if you experiment long enough, you can kind of just... Oh, there you go, they give you a little tooltip there, so that is helpful. Use a gadget. And you only got the one gadget, so there you go. I'm guessing those are Sonic cufflinks. Whoa! Fine. One of us? Hey. Okay. Oh! Well, dang it. Okay, so... That's a thing. So yeah, that didn't work out too well. I definitely want to see if I can lower the difficulty. Because honestly, I want to finish this game today. I don't want to spend like 3 weeks on the same level like I kind of did with GoldenEye. Back. Continue. Ugh, god dang it. Am I really stuck with this difficulty? My hubris! I should have gone for the normal mode. Alright. I'm going to try this one more time, and then I may go back and just quickly burn through it on the lower difficulty if I can't beat this. If that happens, I will start talking about The Man with the Golden Gun, which I saw like 2 weeks ago, and I didn't talk about it last time on stream because the stream cut off. I am actually playing on a PS2, so it is actual hardware. And this is my copy of the game I got like 15 years ago. Oh, it had to have been longer than 15 years ago. Jesus Christ. Alrighty with this. Alright, so I got the door key. At least I know what I'm doing this time. This one? Oh, there you go, elevator card. So there is a reason to go into that room. Okay. You can probably just go with a PS2. No reason to get a PS1 when you can just get a PS2 that emulates it all. Not emulates, but is backwards compatible. Yeah, I think I got 3 PS2s sitting around here somewhere. Come on, come on! Golden original consoles. Yeah, I do. I mean, I got freaking everything around here.
I got what it would feel like
PS2. I got a
Dreamcast over there.
I actually got a Philips CDI sitting around here somewhere. Yeah, the PS1 is like the one I don't feel compelled to own because the PS2 is so perfect at playing those games.
You don't know anything about that, do you?
Elliot's company is involved in for this stream, every game I will play will be on original hardware. So I got my PS2, I got my Xbox, N64. The only one that I might go back into, there's a Game Boy game on, for James Bond. There's a Game Boy game for James Bond. If I can get my hand on a Super Game Boy for cheap, I'll go back and play that one. I'm a collector too. Yeah, I do not have the room for it, and yet I still keep collecting stuff. It is a problem. Actually, I even got a Saturn over there, and I don't even have any cables, games, or controllers for it. It's just a box. I have the box for the Saturn sitting over there. Alright. I am almost certainly going to die, so let's just see what happens. There you go. Okay. So, in my arrogance, I played it on the hard difficulty instead of on the easy. I will not make that mistake going forward. I'm going to go back and quickly burn through the first two levels on easy difficulty.